for the Bible study tonight. We thank you because you brought us for a good purpose, to enlighten us, to educate us, to empower us, and to establish us in the truth. We're asking, O Lord, tonight, your Spirit will register and write the word upon every heart in Jesus' name. We pray, Lord, you restore us to the real foundation of your word. Our hearts, our minds, everything within us will focus on you in Jesus' name. Amen. Strengthen us to walk by faith, amen, to walk in the light, amen, to walk in the truth. Amen. And whenever temptations or trials come, that will give us the strength and the backbone to stand. Amen. We will stand in Jesus' name. Amen. Teach us yourself by your Spirit today. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Welcome you to Revelation chapter 3. And from Revelation chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 7. And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, this says he that is holy, he that is true, he that has the key of David, he that openeth and no man shutteth, and shutteth and no man openeth. I know thy works. Behold, I've set before thee an open door, and no man shall shut it. For thou hast a little strength, and hast kept my word, and thou hast not denied my name. Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews and are not, but do lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet, and to know that I have loved thee, because thou hast kept the word of my patience. I also will keep thee from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth. Behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. Him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out, and I will write upon him the name of my God, and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my God. And I will write upon him my new name. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. We've come to study the word of God tonight, and study the word of God brings us in contact with the Spirit of God himself. Is the one that guides us into the truth. He explains the truth. He expounds the truth. And he makes the truth to penetrate every one of our hearts. Whenever we come to study the word of God, we're not coming for entertainment. It doesn't come to entertain us. It comes to enlighten us. That is to throw light on every area of the word of God we're studying, and to throw light in our hearts so that we will know that is the truth and that is the way of the truth. What key in it? He enlightens us by the teaching of the word. Not only that, he empowers us, because that word has power. That power comes into us, and it's the power for conviction. It's the power for conversion, and it is the power to make us to continue in the strength of the Lord, walking in the way of the Lord. It comes to establish us. You see, if you are not taught in the word of God, maybe you are born again. But even though you are born again, the word of God is not being taught line upon line, precept upon precept. You will not be established in the truth. It comes to empower us so that by the grace of God, until that day of the rapture, we will be strong, will be steady, will be solid, will be steadfast, will be spiritual. And when the Lord will come, we will not be missing out in Jesus' name. Give me a good amen. Amen. As we've been going through the message of Christ to the churches, we've learned something. If this is what God is saying to every church, the church of that time, the church of this time, and the church at the end of the world, and we know that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. What he said to the church at that time is still saying to the church today. And what he's telling us in the various messages of the church shows us his expectation. And shows us his examination. And shows us what he's going to demand when he comes back. And if we're going to make it on that final day, we need to look at what he's saying. Because if he condemns any act, if he condemns any lifestyle, if he condemns any behavior, in everything we're studying, when he comes, he'll condemn that too. If he comments anything, if he appreciates anything, and if he praises anything at that time, you know, all that we're studying, when he comes again, that's exactly what he's going to commend and appreciate and exalt. That's the reason why in every passage and in every message he gives to the church, he says at the end, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says, what the Spirit teaches the church. And I pray that every one of us will have ears to hear in Jesus' name. You see, this church we're talking about now is a faithful church. You'll find that in this church, there's no condemnation at all. It didn't say, I know thy works, I have somewhat against thee. Nothing like that at all. Number one, no condemnation. Number two, there was no corruption. Everything appears upright and righteous and holy and sanctified and pleasing unto the God. There was no corruption at all, and there was no conformity to the world. You see, this church we're talking about, didn't bend a little to the world and bend a little to tradition and bend a little to bad habits or bend a little to any bad thing. No conformity to the word at all, and no compromise of the word of God. They heard the word of God. In fact, Jesus said, you have a little strength and you have kept my word. Even though you have a little strength, you're saved. You have a little strength, you're sanctified. You have a little strength, you're purified, you're holy, and there is no compromise at all of the word of God. A little strength, but no cowardice. You see, there are people, they profess they're strong. I'm a great Christian. I'm a mighty Christian. I'm a Christian that can stand my ground. And then when some things come, they're fearful, they're frightened. The cowards. But look at this church here. There was no cowardice at all. And there was no contradiction of God's will. These were people that had the word of God. And they said, God said so. I believe it, and so it is. And nothing will change their conviction. This is a church, a faithful church. And then God said, Jesus said, because you have kept my word, I have the key of David. I open and no man shutteth. I shut and no man opens. And I set before you an open door opportunities. That's what it means. We're talking today, tonight, about the faithful church blessed with unlimited opportunities. The faithful church blessed with unlimited opportunities. There are many people that are saying, I want a breakthrough, then be faithful. I want an open door, then be faithful. I want greater opportunities, then be faithful. Because he opens the door of opportunity, and the door of breakthrough, and the door of ministry, and the door of service. He opens that door to the people who are faithful unto him. Come back to this Revelation chapter 3. And I'm reading from verse 7. Unto the angel of the church in Philadelphia. We've said it over and over that he wrote to the leader of the church. And he called that leader the angel of the church. Angel of the church. That means angel of the church, a representative of Christ. And it's an ambassador of the Lord. We're looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, I'm reading here from verse 18. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, reading from verse 18, you will see what it says about the leaders in the church, about an ambassador in the church, about a servant of the Lord. It tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 18, all things of God, who has reconciled to himself, has reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. You see that? The ministry of reconciliation. Are you a pastor? Are you a preacher? Are you a bishop? Are you an overseer? Are you a leader in the church? It's giving us a ministry of reconciliation, not a ministry of dividing people, a ministry of conflict, a ministry of driving a wedge between people in the church. No, it's to reconcile. We're peacemakers. We link sinners with the Savior. And we link believers with the bridegroom. And we link the people of God with the power of God. We associate them. We make them come nearer to God. And we make them to receive more of the blessings of the Lord. Reconcile. We reconcile husbands and wives. We reconcile parents and children. We reconcile pastors and members. We reconcile people in the church. We're not for dividing. We're not for conflict. We're not for warfare. It appears some people don't know the calling of the angel of the church, the ambassador of the church. In verse 19, it says, to which that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and has committed unto us, tell me, the word of reconciliation. Not the word of scattering, the word of driving people away, the word of intimidating people, and the word of driving somebody away from the church or from Christ. No, the word of reconciliation is the word that will make a sinner to say, if that is salvation, I want to get saved. If that is salvation and restoration, the backslider says, I want to get restored. Not the word that will make them feel, if that's church, if that's message, if that's doctrine, I don't want anything to do with it. But the word of reconciliation is the word that makes the preacher to love preaching. It's the word that is the ministry that makes the member to want to stay there. I want to stay there because those angels of the church, those ambassadors of the church, they have such a good ministry, attractive, attracting me to the Lord, magnetizing the people unto the Lord. Not the word that scares people away from the Lord. Now then, in verse 20, we are ambassadors for Christ. As though God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled unto God. That's the ministry of that angel to the angel of the church. Then he says, the church in Philadelphia. What does it mean by the church? The church is not the building. The church is the people. The people who are already purchased by the blood of the Lamb. These are people, the blood of Jesus Christ has washed them. The blood of Jesus Christ has cleansed them. The blood of Jesus Christ has purified them. They are washed and they are whiter than snow. That's the church. The people who have not been cleansed by the blood of the Lamb, they are not part of the church. They may come to church, they may read the Bible, and they may appear to be religious, but it's when you are washed in the blood of the Lamb, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, purchased by the blood of the Lamb. That's the church. We're looking at Acts of the Apostles, chapter 20. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 20, verse 28. It says, take it therefore unto yourselves. It's talking to pastors now. It's talking to preachers. It's talking to overseers. It says, take it unto yourselves. Do you know you need to take it unto yourself as an angel to the church, as an ambassador of the Lord Jesus Christ, as a servant of the Lord has said to go and bring them in. It says, while you're doing that, mind your language. While you're doing that, mind your action. While you're doing that, mind your behavior. While you're doing that, take heed unto yourselves and to all the flock. Watch your relationship with the people in the church. Watch your relationship with the women in the church. Watch your relationship with the men in the church. What's your relationship with the children in the church? That's what it says. It says you take it yourself. And then it says you take it to all the flock over the which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers to feed. What? Tell me out loud. We feed The physical building? No. Who are we feeding? The people, the converts, the disciples, the saints, the children of God, everyone that belongs to the Lord. It says, we feed them. How do you feed physically? You know, somebody brings food on the table, and then as he puts the food on the table, before you settle down to want to eat, it brings out a cane. You're going to enjoy that food. Before you take in the food, it begins to say some corrosive words that will poison your heart, take your appetite away. That's not how to feed. If you're going to feed, you feed in love. You feed in mercy. You feed with excitement. You are joyful that you're serving the people of God, the bread of life. And you feed the church of God, which he has purchased with his own blood. That's the church. That's why he's saying, that church is so precious to me. And I'm writing to the angel. I'm speaking to the angel of the church of Philadelphia. And he's saying that this is what you do. Come back to Revelation chapter 3, verse 7. And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, these things is he that is holy, he that is true, he that has the key of David, he that openeth and no man shutteth, he that shutteth and no man openeth. He's talking about the Lord Jesus Christ, a God, a Father, a Son, Jesus Christ, to be the propitiation for our sins, to send us and to help us understand what the gospel all about. And what the good news is all about, what the glad tidings is all about. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth, were to bring people to believe the word of God and people to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ so they can be saved. And it is those who are saved, they now come together like an assembly, like a church. And then we're feeding them and feeding them and feeding them. We give them, we've given the word of repentance. And now they become born again. And we're still feeding. Then we tell them about restitution. We tell them about restoration, about correcting things that are wrong in their lives. That if they have stolen before, here is what to do. We're feeding them. And then we're feeding the word of righteousness, that a child of God should live a righteous life, a purified life, a sanctified life. And then we lead them to the experience of sanctification. They consecrate their lives to the Lord. They lay everything on the altar, and they plead for the blood of the Lamb to cleanse them, wash them, purge them, purify them, and sanctify them. And then we're leading to the power of the Holy Ghost, that you're saved, don't stop there, you're sanctified. But remember, we're feeding them, because that is the church, and that is what the Lord has called us to. And then when they are made holy in their hearts, purified in their hearts, we're telling them there is power in the Holy Ghost, for you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses to me, both in Jerusalem and in Judea and in Samaria, and then to the uttermost part of the earth. And then we're reminding them, after you're filled with the Holy Ghost, immersed in the Holy Ghost, and you're saturated with the Holy Ghost, and you have the power, the presence of the Holy Ghost in you, we tell them, you have that so you can evangelize, so you can go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. And then we keep on teaching them and feeding them every time. And every time they come to study the word of God, I was fed. I received something. I got something. I became stronger. I became more committed to the will of God, to the ways of God, to the word of God. That's what he has called us to do. And that is what the angel of that church in Philadelphia, the pastor of that church in Philadelphia, the ambassador of Christ in that church in Philadelphia, that's how he did. That's how they became faithful. That's how they became favored. And that's how they became fruitful. And I were talking about them, and I pray the qualities of Christ and the qualities of the Christian life in this church will come to every life here. I will get your life over there. You'll be strong. You'll be steadfast, saturated with the word of God, and the grace of God will multiply in your life in Jesus' name. You become faithful. You become fruitful, and you be favored in Jesus' name. Talking about the church, the faithful church, blessed with unlimited opportunities. There are three things we're looking at. Number one, Christ's irreproachable perfection and omnipotence. We're talking about Christ first, that's our Savior. Christ, that's our Redeemer. Christ, that's our Sanctifier. Christ, that's our Deliverer. Christ, that's our Lord. That's our King. Christ, that's the one that is coming again. And we're talking about Christ's irreproachable perfection and omnipotence. And then, number two, point number two here, we have the conqueror's irrevocable privileges and opportunities. The Lord said, because you are faithful, and because of you obedient to my word, and because you have given in to every word that you have heard, you have submitted yourself to the word, and you have not denied my name, I open the door before you. A door that nobody can shut. The conqueror's irrevocable privilege and opportunities. Point number three, Christ's irreversible promise. He gives us a promise to the overcomer. Christ's irreversible promise to the overcomers. And I pray that that promise will be yours, will be mine, will be ours in Jesus' name. I want a good, good amen over there. Amen. We're looking at number one, and it's Christ's irreproachable perfection and omnipotence. We're looking at Revelation chapter 3. Revelation chapter 3, we're reading from verse 7. Revelation chapter 3, verse 7. And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, this thing says he that is holy. That's number one. The attribute of Christ. The quality of Christ. The character of Christ. And the very nature of Christ. He that is holy. Number two, he that is true. It's talking about Christ. It's talking about our Savior. It says, he that is true, his promises are true. His precepts are true. And his prophecies are true. His word is true completely. His work is true. His ways are true. Everything about him is true. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. He that is true. Then he tells us more about him. He that has the key of David. That's the key of power, the key of authority, the key that opens and no one can shut. He that has the key of David, he that openeth and no man shutteth, he that shutteth and no man openeth. Let's look at that one by one. He's talking about Christ, and he talks about Christ's irreproachable perfection and omnipotence. Number one, he that is holy. When you think about Christ, when you talk about Christ, when you look at Christ, when you examine the life of Christ here on earth, and even before he came, and after he's gone, number one, he's essentially holy. Essentially holy. Number two, is entirely holy. There is nothing unholy about him, nothing unrighteous about him, nothing that will offend God about his life. Holy, essentially. Holy, entirely. Holy, eternally. He is eternally holy. He has been holy from before the foundation of the world and at the foundation of the world. And when he came to this world, he said, which of you convinces me of sin? He lived a perfect life. And that's why he says, this thing says he that is holy. Holy, eternally. Not only that, he makes his followers holy. That's very important. Not just that he's holy alone, he transfers that holiness. He transmits that holiness. He transfuses that holiness into our lives. And if you say you are following the Lord, you have any connection with the Lord, and you have any association with the Lord, because he is holy, that's his attitude, that's his attribute. He also passes that holiness into us. He gives us a holy heart. He makes our lives holy. He makes our behavior holy. He makes our thoughts holy. He makes our plans holy. He makes our aspirations holy. Because he is holy through and through, essentially, entirely, and eternally, he also passes that on, and he makes us holy. If he has not done it yet, he'll do it for you. I said he'll do it for you. He'll make you holy through and through in Jesus' name. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 7, talking about Christ our Savior. Hebrews chapter 7, talking about our Redeemer. Hebrews chapter 7, talking about our high priest and the essential and the eternal and effective holiness of his heart, of his life, of everything about him. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 7, and we're reading from verse 26. It says, "For such an high priest became us who is holy." The very first characteristic that is pointed out about this Christ is that he is holy and harmless. If you are holy, you'll be harmless. And then also it says, undefiled. If you are holy, you'll be undefiled. And separate from sinners. If you are holy, you'll be separate from sinners and made higher than the heavens. That's talking about Christ. But then, what does he do? What's the consequence of that on your life? What's the consequence of that in my life? Looking at what he does now, he makes his followers holy. He makes his disciples holy. He makes his children holy. He makes the people that are born again, that are converted, through the cleansing of the blood of the Lamb, he makes them holy. Look at Romans chapter 11. Romans chapter 11, and I'm reading from verse 16. Romans chapter 11, verse 16. It says, "For if the first fruits be holy, the lump is also holy. And if the roots be holy, so are the branches," all the branches, all the branches. If you're a branch in the vine, and you're a member of the body of Christ, because he is holy, he also passes that on to you. He makes you holy. And you'll not say, "Well, I cannot be holy," of course. Well, if you cannot be, that means you're not of Christ. If you're of Christ, he makes us holy. Romans chapter 12, I'm reading from verse 1. Romans chapter 12, verse 1. "I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice." Tell me the next word there. Holy. Your body. You're holy in the body. Your hand will not touch anything unclean. Your mouth will not say anything unclean. Your eyes will not look at, gaze at things that are unclean. Your ears will not be given to unclean speech. And your feet will not walk to places that are unclean. And your body will not wear any kind of dress that will make other people unclean. Because you present your body a living sacrifice unto God, holy. We're looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 3. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, I'm reading here from verse 17. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17. "If any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy, for the temple of God is holy." Which temple ye are? The temple of God is holy. Which temple ye are? He makes us holy. If you're a child of God, there'll be holiness there. Ephesians chapter 1, I'm looking at verse 4. Ephesians chapter 1, and we're reading from verse 4. Here he tells us, according as he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that, listen to this, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. Before him in love. Holiness does not prevail, lead to hatred. Holiness does not lead to fighting. Holiness does not lead to bitterness. Holiness does not lead to rancor. It says it makes us to be in holiness as well as in love. That's what it does. And that's the promise he has given us, because it says he that is holy, and he makes us holy, he'll make you holy. We're looking at Ephesians chapter 2, verse 21. It says, "In whom all the building, fitly framed together, groweth into an holy temple in the Lord." Holy temple in the Lord. That's why it's called us to this life of holiness in our thoughts, in our mind, in our aspirations, in our desires. Holiness unto the Lord. 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1, I'm reading here from verse 15. In 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 15, here it tells us, it says, "But as he which has called you is holy, So be ye holy in all manner of conversation. There's no department of your life, no section of your life that will reserve for uncleanness, for defilement, and for holiness. But it says every part should be holy in all manner of conversation, because it is written, be ye holy, tell me the rest, for I am holy, you will be. Because the blood of Jesus is able. And because it's able, it will fulfill it in every one of our lives in Jesus' name. I'm coming back to Revelation chapter 3, verse 7. Revelation chapter 3, and we're looking at verse 7. And Christ here is talking about himself. Christ here is introducing himself to the angel of the church in Philadelphia. And you see what he says about himself. He says in chapter 3, verse 7, chapter 3, verse 7, here is what he's telling us. He says, unto the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, the sixth is he that is holy. That's one. Number two now, he that is true. He that is true. And he's talking about Christ, about our Savior. He's talking about Christ. He's talking about his nature. He's talking about his life. He's talking about everything about him, his character. He's talking about his, what he transfers unto us as well. We're looking at 1 John chapter 5. 1 John chapter 5, and we're looking at verse 20. 1 John chapter 5, we're reading from verse 20. 1 John chapter 5, verse 20, and we know that the Son of God is come. Who is that? Tell me out loud now. We know that the Son of God, Jesus, has come, and he has given us an understanding that we may know him. Tell me, that is true. That we may know him, that is true. And love him, that is true. And lean on him, that is true. And have that same characteristic, and have that same attribute of being truthful also in us. We're looking at Matthew chapter 22. Matthew chapter 22, I'm reading from verse 16, talking about who Christ is. And he still remains the same today, yesterday, today, and forever. Jesus Christ. We're looking at Matthew chapter 22, verse 16. Here we have the attributes of Christ, and it says, and they sent out unto him their disciples with the Herodians, saying, Master, we know that thou, tell me, are true. We know, without any pretense, we know. Whatever the Pharisees are saying, we know. Whatever lies Herod himself or others may lie, we know. And whatever those religious hypocrites may say against you, concerning you, this we know. And no matter sometimes even we ourselves, when we try to cajole and to deceive ourselves because we didn't want to believe this, we know. This is what you know about Christ. Everybody knows this about Christ. Heavens know. The angels know. And human beings know that this is the true one. That's why it says, we know that thou art true and teachest the way of God in truth. Neither carest thou for any man, for thou regardest not the person of men. What's the consequence of that? That Christ is true. What's the consequence of that? That he is the personification of the truth. What's the consequence of that? That we know that thou art true. And he introduces himself and he says, these things says he that is holy and he that is true. Because he's holy, he makes us holy. And because he's true, he also transforms all his own people and he makes us true, makes us truthful. And he gives us that nature, that same nature of his. And he gives us that same characteristics of his that he makes us true. And I pray that this will be your experience, our experience together in Jesus' name. Amen. Give me a good amen. Amen. In John chapter 8, John chapter 8, here's where it starts. John chapter 8, I'm reading here from verse 32. John chapter 8, verse 32. It says in verse 32, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Everyone that comes to Christ, what changes us? What saves us? What sanctifies us? What transforms our lives is the truth. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. The truth of Christ makes us free from external sin. It makes us free from inward sin. It makes us free from depravity. It makes us free from the Adamic nature. Ye shall know the truth. When we know the truth of what Christ has done on the cross of Calvary, and we know the truth of what Christ is and what Christ can do, and the transforming power of Christ, that truth sets us free. Not only that, he has sent the Holy Spirit unto us, and is still about the truth. Look at John chapter 16. In John chapter 16, I'm reading from verse 13. John chapter 16, we're looking at verse 13. It says in verse 13, "How be it when he, the Spirit of truth, has come." The Spirit of truth. God is true. Christ is true. And the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of truth. When he is come, he will guide you into, tell me, all truth. He doesn't guide us into false doctrine, into false prophecy, and into anything evil. When he's come, he'll guide us into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he shall show you things to come. Is the Spirit of truth. And he guides us into truth. And when you're a real child of God, you know what? It will make you depart from anything and everything that is not truthful, that is not true. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, we're reading from verse 2. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 2. It says, "But I've renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by the manifestation of the truth." Manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. Makes us truthful, makes us true. You see, there are people, those who are not in Christ, there are people, those who were in Christ before, but they've gone away from Christ now. They do not understand that if you're going to have an abiding relationship with the Lord, you must abide in the truth. You must remain in the truth. And anything untruthful, even in a slight way, anything untruthful in a very minute way, you're not going to take part in. But there are people who have deviated from the truth. There are people who have gone away from the truth. And in fact, they teach themselves to lie. And they teach themselves for unfaithfulness, untruthfulness. Look at Jeremiah chapter 9, and I'm reading from verse 5. Jeremiah chapter 9, verse 5, very important to open your Bible. It says, "And they deceive everyone his neighbor, and will not speak the truth. They have taught their tongue to speak lies, and weary themselves to commit iniquity." You see that passage? It says, if they knew Christ before, they're backsliding. Because now they teach themselves to speak lies. They will not speak the truth. Look at this. I'm going to read that again. We look at Jeremiah chapter 9, verse 5. "For they will deceive every man his neighbor. They'll deceive everyone husband. They'll deceive everyone his wife. They'll deceive everyone their pastor. They'll deceive everyone their boss. They'll deceive everyone their employer. They'll deceive everyone their teacher." It's a world of liars, a world of untruthful people. It says they will deceive everyone, his neighbor, and will not speak the truth. Will not speak the truth. It's like they made a covenant with the devil, because he's the father of lies, and every liar has made a covenant with the devil. It's like they made a covenant with the devil. Even if you beat them, chastise them, discipline them, do whatever, deny them of whatever, they have taught themselves so effectively to tell lies. And even though they know the consequence of lying, they still do that because they have severed relationship with the Lord. And they will deceive everyone, his neighbor, and will not speak the truth. They have taught, they have taught, they They have touched their tongue to speak lies and weary themselves to commit iniquity. Look at verse 6, that the inhabitation is in the midst of the siege. Through the siege, they refuse to know me, says the Lord. We're coming to Revelation chapter 3. Revelation chapter 3, and we're coming to verse 7. We're looking at the attributes of Christ. We're looking at the identification of Christ. We're looking at the identity of Christ, the way he introduced himself. And he says unto the angel of the church in Philadelphia, write, this thing says he that is holy, he that is true, and now he that has the key of David. He that has the key of David. That passage is coming from Isaiah chapter 22 and verse 22. Isaiah chapter 22, verse 22. The key of David. The key of David. Here Christ introduces himself and he says, I am the one that has the key of David. Isaiah chapter 22. We're looking at verse 22. Chapter 22 and verse 22. It tells us here, and the key of the house of David will I lay upon his shoulder, so he shall open and none shall shut. Give me a good amen there. Amen. And he shall shut and none shall open. Another amen. He's talking about the final authority of Christ. That Christ has the final authority. If he says yes, nobody can say no. If he says no, nobody can say yes. If he closes the door and shuts the door against anyone to come into the kingdom, nobody can open that door. And if he opens the door for you to come into the kingdom, no one can shut the door. That's why he says he has the key of authority. He has the key of power, and he has the key of control. He has the key to let you in, or he has the key to shut you out. He says, I'm the one, he that is holy. I'm the one, he that is true. I'm the one, he that has the key of David. He that shutteth, no man openeth. He that openeth, and no man shutteth. How does he open? What does he open? How does he use the key to open? How does he use the key to shut out? We're looking at Luke chapter 24. In Luke chapter 24, I'm reading from verse 45. Luke chapter 24, and we're reading from verse 45 about Jesus Christ, how he uses the key, and then he opens. And I pray he'll open the door in your life in Jesus' name. Look at Luke chapter 24, and let us read from verse 45. In verse 45, then opened he their understanding that they might understand the scriptures. That's Christ. That's Christ. He has the key. No matter how dull a person may be, and no matter how darkened the heart may be, no matter how ignorant a person may be, when Christ uses that key that he has, and he has the control, and he has the final authority, and he opens the door of understanding, you'll understand the gospel. You'll understand the word of God. You know, there are people that read the Bible every time they, I don't understand. Why don't you come to Christ? Why don't you lean on Christ? Why don't you believe in Christ? Why don't you open your heart to Christ and say, Lord, you're the Lord of the word, and the word is the word of the Lord. I want you to apply the key and open my understanding. You'll understand the scriptures in Jesus' name. Acts of the Apostles chapter 14. I'm reading from verse 27. Acts of the Apostles chapter 14, and we're reading from verse 27. Here it tells us about opening the door. Look at this kind of door. It says, Acts chapter 14, verse 27, and when they were come and gathered the church together, they rehearsed all that God had done with them. Look at this. And how he had, tell me out loud, he had opened the door of faith unto the Gentiles. As we go out to preach the word of God to the Gentiles, maybe our explanation is not enough. Maybe our preaching is not enough. And maybe our passion is not enough. Maybe the power we have to communicate the gospel is not enough. But when Christ comes along, and he walks with you, and he opens the door of faith to the Gentiles, they will be born again in Jesus' name. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 16, I'm reading from verse 14. Acts chapter 16, verse 14. And a certain woman named Lydia, a seller of purple of the city of Thyatira, which worshiped God, heard us. Listen to this. Whose heart the Lord opened. Whose heart the Lord opened. That she attended unto the things which were spoken of Paul. Jesus said, I have the key of David. I open and no one can shut. And when you're preaching to people, or even you yourself, when you're hearing the word of God, if it appears the word is not penetrating, something is happening to you. If it appears the word of God is not making any impact, you hear of repentance, you can't repent. And you hear of restitution, and there's no grace to do restitution. And you hear of righteousness, and there's no passion, there's no interest to move on and pursue righteousness. You hear of holiness and purity, and there's no passion, there's no desire. From day to day, from year to year, you still remain the same, impure, unsanctified, unholy, because your heart has not been open to those wonderful experiences. Go to Christ, lean on Christ, and say, Lord, something is happening here. Why is my heart so dense? Why is my heart so dead? And why is my heart so close to this important message and experience of holiness? It will open your heart. He'll make you holy, make you pure. If that heart is closed, bring it to the Lord today. He'll make a definite change in Jesus' name. We're looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 12. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, and we're looking at verse 12. He opens the door. He opens the door. He did it before. He's going to do it again. He did it for other people. He will do it for you in Jesus' name. We're looking at 2 Corinthians, and we're looking at chapter 2, and we're reading from verse 12. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, and we're reading from verse 12. He will do it. I said he will do it. He will not fail. Because he's a God who has the power. And when he decides to open the door, who can shut the door? 2 Corinthians chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 12. Furthermore, when I came to Troas to preach Christ's gospel, a door was opened unto me of the Lord. A door was opened unto me of the Lord. And while you go out evangelizing, you go out preaching the word of God, you will pray that, Lord, I know you are the one that has the key. You have the key to the hearts of men. You have the key to the minds of people. You have the key to open the door so that they'll come out of their ignorance. They'll come out in Jesus' name. And that's how your word will come with conviction. And your word will come with power. And your word will turn them around and turn them to the Lord, because the Lord is walking with you, opening the doors of the hearts of the people. There's a serious area of this opening of the door and shutting of the door. We're looking at Matthew chapter 25. Matthew chapter 25, the day is coming that people will finish their lifestyle, they'll finish everything here on earth, and they want to get to the great beyond. And if they have believed on the Lord Jesus Christ here on earth, and they have become like wise virgins, they were saved, wise virgins, they were sanctified, wise virgins, they walked in the light, wise virgins, they lived in the truth according to the word of the truth, on that final day, the Lord will open the door for them, and they'll go in. But if they have heard about Christ and they didn't believe, they have heard about Christ, they were in, they went away from Christ. They have heard about Christ, and they went back to the pollutions of the world, and they went back to all those evil things they have vomited before. That day, final day coming, the door will be shut, and nobody can open that door to them. Matthew chapter 25, I'm reading from verse 11. Matthew 25, verse 11. Afterward came also the other virgins, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. Their friends could not open the door, open to us. Their pastors could not open the door, open to us. And their religious leaders could not open the door, open to us, because Christ has the key on that final day, either to open the door or shut the door. And once the door is shut, that's it forever and ever. We're looking at Luke chapter 13, verse 25. Luke chapter 13, I'm reading from verse 25. Look at what it says here. in Luke chapter 13, verse 25, when once the master of the house is risen up and has shut the door, and ye begin to stand without and to knock at the door, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us, and he shall answer and say unto you, I know you not whence ye are. Not born again, I know ye not who ye are. I know you not whence ye are. Not sanctified, not purified, not prepared for the kingdom, to enter into the kingdom. And then verse 26, then shall ye begin to say, we have eaten and drunk in thy presence, and thou hast taught in our streets. But he shall say, I tell you, I know you not whence ye are. Depart from me. Tell me the rest. All ye workers of iniquity. They had the word, they were not converted. They had the word, they were not saved. They had the word, they were not restored. They had the word, they were not made holy. They had the word, they were not sanctified. They had the word, they were presuming, well, we've eaten with him, we've drunk with him, and on that final day we're going to enter, and lo and behold, final disappointment. I pray you'll not be disappointed. But if he's going to open the door of the kingdom to you on that final day, he must open the door of your heart now. And the word of God must come in and penetrate. And the word that transforms and changes and converts must totally circumcise your heart and must totally saturate your heart and must totally change your heart. You must be saved. You must be made holy. You must be sanctified. That's what it takes. That's what it takes. And when that has happened on that final day, when the saints go marching in, you'll march on with the people of God in Jesus' name. We're coming to point number two now. And in point number two, we're looking at the conqueror's irreversible privilege and opportunities. The conqueror's irreversible privileges and opportunities. We're looking at Revelation chapter 3. Revelation chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 8 all through to verse 10. Look at verse 8. It says in verse 8, I know thy works. He always says that because he knows everyone. You might be in the corner somewhere, he knows your works. You might be hiding somewhere, he knows your works. You might tell your partner, your associate in behavior, don't tell anybody, but he knows your works. You might do it outside the church, he knows your works. You might do it under the cover of darkness, but he knows your works. You might hide it from everybody, but he knows your works. He knows your heart. He knows your life. He knows your behavior. He knows all the actions of you, and private and public. He says in verse 8, I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man shall shut it. But you know, you cannot say amen to that if you are not keeping to the word of God. If your heart has not been open to the word of God, if you're not converted, if you're not a real child of God, if you're not transparently holy, transparently righteous, you cannot just say amen, amen. You're trying to get the letter that is written to a faithful church. You're trying to open a letter that is written to a loyal church. You're trying to open a letter that is written to an obedient church. You're trying to open a letter that is written to a steadfast, sanctified church. It's only when you have been saved and you're sanctified and you're holy and you're obedient to the word of God. It says, I know your works. And I know that because you have opened yourself to the truth, to the word of God, I set this door before you. And it's an open door. It says, because thou hast a little strength and hast kept my word and hast not denied my name. Look at verse 9. Behold, I will make of them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews and are not, but do lie. Behold, I will make them come and worship before thy feet, and to know that I have loved thee. Look at verse 10. It said, because thou hast kept the word of my patience. You see that? Because, underline that. It says, if you are faithful, if you are loyal, if you're obedient, if you're steadfast, and if you're following through and following the will and the way and the word of God, it says, because that was kept the word of my patience, I also will keep thee from the hour of temptation. It's talking about the final tribulation, because it says, which shall come to try them that dwell on the face of the earth. It says, because of that faithfulness, and because of that loyalty, and because of giving yourself fully, completely unto the Lord. He says, that's the reason why I make you this promise, and it's a conqueror's irrevocable privilege and opportunities. It tells us that these are faithful people, and because they are faithful people, he opens the door unto them. I pray this will be your experience in Jesus' name. And then he says, you have a little strength. That's telling us something. Even with the little strength they had, they lived a victorious life. There are people that are saying, I have only a little strength. Okay, if you have a little strength, be obedient to the word of God. Have a little strength, then be holy. Have a little strength, then walk uprightly and walk righteously. Don't you know what he says? Even a little faith will do. We're looking at Matthew chapter 17. Matthew chapter 17, and I'm reading here from verse 20. Matthew chapter 17, and we're reading from verse 20. Little strength, little power, little faith, little grace. Look at what it will do. In Matthew chapter 17, verse 20, and Jesus said unto them, because of your unbelief, for verily I say unto you, if ye have faith as a grain of mustard seed, ye shall say unto this mountain, be removed hence to yonder place, and it shall remove, and nothing shall be impossible unto you. What that means is that you have little strength, you overcome every sin, no matter the mountain of sin, no matter the mountain of difficulty, no matter the mountain of temptation, you are going to overcome. Yeah. I said you are going to overcome. Yeah. You have a little strength, a little faith, a little grace, and God, that gives you an overcoming power. Overcoming power. And then he said, you have kept the word of my patience. What does that mean? They were saved. Without salvation, they couldn't keep the word of his patience. We're looking at John chapter 17. John chapter 17, we're looking at verse 6. I have manifested thy name unto the men which thou gavest me out of the world. Then it says, thine they were, and thou gavest them me, and they have kept thy word. Saved, they have kept thy word. Repentant, they have kept thy word. Obedient, they have kept thy word. They had the grace of God in them. They have kept thy word. And it is the grace of God in us. It is that salvation experience that helps us, that when temptation comes, whether people are there or not, if the grace is inside us, we'll be obedient to the word of the Lord. I can't do that. I'm born again. I can't go there. I'm born again. I can't dress that way. I'm born again. I can't eat that thing. I'm born again. I can't drink that thing. I'm born again. I know the word of God, and the word of God has power, has effect, has authority on my life. They have kept thy word. And it doesn't matter whether church members are there or not. It doesn't matter whether the pastor will hear or you will not hear. You're not doing it for church members. You're not doing it for the pastor of the church. You're doing it because you have connection with the Lord. Because you've got strength from the Lord, and because you've got salvation from the Lord, that's why no matter where you are faithful to the word of God and obedient to the word of God. They have kept my word. You'll keep the word of God in Jesus' name. And then he says something that he said, I'll make them of the synagogue of Satan. They will come to bow under your feet. Somebody there, give me a good amen. You know, I pity these people that say they are saved. They don't know their rights. They're always running to so-called prayer warriors. And they're always running to pray for me, pray for me, pray for me. And those prayer warrior people too, they make a big deal of pray, 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 pray. And they don't allow people to have the strength of their own and the might of the Lord on their own, and to be able to stand. And because these people, they cannot overcome little cockroach, they cannot overcome little mosquito, they cannot overcome a little worm, they cannot overcome a little problem, always running to people. And when temptations come, who are they running to? When trials come, who are they running to? But Jesus said, even when you have a little strength, you don't need to run to anybody. He says, I'll give you such conviction, I'll give you such confidence, I'll give you such power, I'll give you such courage, that all those people that are against your life, they'll come to bow before you. I said they'll come to bow before you. And the amen you're saying, church, you must carry out what you're outside there. Not that, you know, in church we're strong, and everyone will step outside there, and those people come, anytime they come now, you will not shake. Amen. You will not tremble. Amen. You'll not be looking for prayer warriors. Amen. You'll say, I will stand. Somebody there. Somebody there, tell them. You don't compromise. You don't look down. You don't bend down. You're not timid. You know that the one that lives inside you is greater than the one that lives outside there. I see some conquerors right there. I'm looking at Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 49. And we're reading from verse 23. Isaiah chapter 49. And we're reading here from verse 43. This victory, God will give you the victory. You will enjoy the victory. You will live in victory. And even when you're alone all by yourself, the Lord will give you testimony in Jesus' name. Look at this, Isaiah chapter 49, verse 23. The kings shall be thy nursing fathers, and the queens shall be thy nursing mothers, and they shall bow down to thee with their face toward the earth. Amen. You didn't hear that one. Amen. They shall bow down to thee with their face toward the earth. Amen. And lick up the dust of thy feet. Amen. Thou shalt know that I am the Lord, for they shall not be ashamed that wait for me. Amen. I will not be ashamed. I said, I will not be ashamed. We're looking at Isaiah chapter 60, verse 14. Isaiah chapter 60, verse 14. This is a promise for you. The sons also of them that afflicted thee, they afflicted you in the past, they'll do that no more. The sons also of them that afflicted thee shall come bending unto thee. And all they that despise thee shall bow themselves down at the soles of thy feet. Amen. And they shall call thee the city of the Lord, Amen. The Zion of the Holy One of Israel. I got the victory. I don't know about somebody there. I said, I got the victory. That victory will be permanent in Jesus' name. Victory over sin. Victory over Satan. Amen. Victory over sickness. Amen. Victory over circumstances. Amen. Victory all the days of your life. Amen. You will not yield to temptation. Amen. You will not bend before the opposers and the persecutors. Amen. You will bend before you in Jesus' name. Point number three, Christ's irreversible promise to overcomers. Christ's irreversible promise to overcomers. We're coming back to Revelation chapter 3. Revelation chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 11. In verse 11, behold, I come quickly. He is coming. I said he's coming again. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. I want you to meditate a little, and if you have pen, put it on paper, paper in front of you there. What do you have? You have Christ. You have the Word of God. You have sound doctrine. You have salvation. You have sanctification. You have holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. You have courage. You have conviction. You have a responsibility. You have an inheritance. You have a crown. You have the promises the Lord has given you. And you have something that others in your family do not have. And you have an assignment that God himself has given you that is not transferable. This is yours. He's giving this to you. What have you got? It says, that which you have, hold fast. You see, there are people, they don't know the importance of what they have. A little problem, they're like, you know, I used to, when I was very young, I knew a particular family, young couple. Well, they were older than myself at that time. I wasn't married. I was even in the secondary school at that time, a teenager. But I knew this family. Any little problem, the wife, the woman will be packing. I'm leaving. And the husband was, okay, don't go. And then any little problem again, I'm going now. And one day, the husband, was fed up. Something happened. Something negligible. Something, we can overlook. I was wondering in my heart. I couldn't talk to her because, they were older than I was. And I'm going. And the husband did not beg anymore. I'm going. And then she was packing and looking back. As if, and the husband made up his mind this time. You want to go? Go. And then she packed. And the man was still looking. And then she picked that load. And the shame of coming back, and she left. And eventually now she was sending somebody to the husband to say, come to my mother's house and come and apologize, unbelievers. And the man did not budge. And she remained lonely like that for a long time until something happened. She came back again. But after coming back that time, anything that happened, she wasn't, I'm going. Everything was wiped off her mouth. There are people, they don't know what they have. A little problem, I'm going. Where are you going? You're going back to Satan, going back to darkness, going back to the world. I've been born again now since 1964, and I've not gone out. I'm staying. I said, I am staying. Where are you there? You will stay in Jesus' name. If you don't wait, how will your enemies come to bow before your feet? If you don't wait, how will that synagogue of Satan come to say they're sorry? If you don't wait, all those sons of oppressors, how will they come to you to say, now we know that you have the key as your Savior, your Lord has the key. Then they'll be begging you for something because their happiness and their inheritance, everything will depend upon you eventually. Because God has promoted you. God has lifted you up. If you know what you have, you'll not be saying, I'm going. If you know what you possess, you'll not be saying, I'm going. Why are you going? What has happened to you that has not happened to other people? Take that language out of your mouth. You will stay. You will possess. Everything God has given you, you will enjoy. Nobody will drive you away from your inheritance in Christ in Jesus' name. You have a crown waiting for you. Nobody will take it from you. You have the favor of God waiting for you. Nobody will take it away from you. That which thou hast, I have something. Hold fast until it comes. Let no man take your crown. Look at verse 12. He that overcometh, that's me. He that overcometh, that's me. They come from any direction. They do anything. They might stand tall and they might threaten. But there's nothing in that empty threat because who I have inside me is greater than who he has inside him. And I will stand. I said, I will stand. Whatever they try, whatever situation, that the Lord dwells within you. He says, I will never leave you and I will never forsake you. When temptations come, you'll overcome. When trials come, you'll overcome. When poverty comes, you'll overcome. When joblessness comes, you'll overcome. When sickness comes, you'll overcome. If evil spirits try to knock at your door, you will overcome. Where are those overcomers there? You overcome in Jesus' name. Him that overcometh, I will make a pillar in the temple of my God. Wonderful. And he shall go no more out. And I will write upon him my new name, the new name of my God, and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my God. And I will write upon him my new name. Something wonderful is waiting for me. Something great is waiting for me. Something precious is waiting for me. I said for me. I said, for me, I'll see you in glory land. You'll be more beautiful than this. You'll be more precious than this. And when we see you, even angels will wonder at you. Just a little bit of trial, just a little bit of difficulty, just a little bit of temptation, and you overcome, and you overcome, and you overcome, and then the trumpet will stand, and then those who are dead in Christ, they'll rise up, and then we which are alive, I'll be among them. We which are alive, I said I'll be among them, will be caught up together to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall I, and so shall you, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. May the Lord confirm it to your life in Jesus' name. He that has an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. Somebody there has an ear to hear. Somebody there is going to be obedient. Somebody there is going to be steadfast. Somebody there is waiting for the coming of the Lord. And when he comes, you will not be left behind. What are you there? Why don't you rise up and tell the Lord, oh Lord, I'll be an overcomer. Oh Lord, I'll be an overcomer. Remember, we're serving him that is holy. We're serving him that is true. We're serving him that has the key of David. We're serving him that opens and no man can shut. We're serving him that will make your enemies to bow before you. We're serving him who will make us victorious until the final day. We're serving him who has the power to hold you. And then you hold on until the very end, you will not fall. You will not fail. You will not backslide. Until he comes, you'll be standing firm in the Lord until the final day. Open your mouth and talk to the Lord. He'll give you strength. He'll give you power. He'll make you able. Make you able. Make you able. Talk to the Lord in prayer before you go.